Good afternoon, fellow Toastmasters. Welcome to the last TLI session of the day. Thank you for still being here, because I know how tempting it was to walk out that door and how inviting the rest of the day is, but I think you made a good decision to be here this afternoon for this session. This is one of those advanced sessions, even if you're a new Toastmaster. It is meant to take the Toastmaster experience to the next level and deal with what's called soft skills. Soft doesn't mean unimportant. It just means it's not part of the nuts and bolts that are integral to you learning your job as an officer and then doing a good job once you bring it to your club. This is something that permeates the whole club experience. And as a bonus, this will probably be things that you can take to your own relationships at home and at work. I like hitting a bunch of birds with one stone, but I like birds, so that's not a good analogy, right? But I like when there's multiple benefits to something. Things you have to look forward to is a short TED Talk. We'll do our own little discussions. Have you apply, we'll call on people, and then we'll ask and have a little interaction there. My hope is that this 45 minutes goes quickly and that you'll be able to be on your way. But we will start with telling you who I am. My name is Diane Trevor Shipman. I've been a Toastmaster for 10 years. My home club is Power Play.
Woo! That's
Jim. Thank you, April. Yes. I like when people like to sit in the front row. Right. I have two distinguished Toastmasters. I think I'll wait for the new Pathways program to work on the third. I just finished being an area director for the second time. I've been division or district secretary for 1.5 times. I just filled in for someone who could not continue the year. I have been president a lot, vice president of education. This is my first time as a treasurer. And yes, I did go to my treasurer's training this afternoon.
She was at my table.
That's right. She can verify. Thank you. I'll pay you later. That's right. Trust but verify. This is, and if you could come to one of these tables, ladies, please. Thank you. As my real job, I'm an educator. I just retired a year ago from community college teaching. I taught public speaking, interpersonal communication, was division chair for communication and fine arts. Had this year to retire and enjoy it. Yeah, I'm going back part-time teaching in a couple of weeks because it's something I love. I love facilitating. I've been doing Toastmasters leadership facilitation for about 2 years now, and it's a great experience. So I thank you for being here, because you're the one who's going to take everything you're learning back to the club. My suggestion to you is any really good teaching points that you have, turn it into a speech. Turn it into a 5 to 7 minute speech so that you can get manual credit and you can be teaching the group something. Let's look at what we'll be doing today. Our focus is to look at the essential aspects of listening, as well as the benefits to the club and its members, which of course will also benefit you at home and at work. And then it requires true effort. Too many people think, I can hear. What's the difference between hearing and listening? Hearing is a passive activity. You hear things, like I'm hearing a little buzz from these fluorescent lights. That can be annoying until I can switch it off or focus on something else. But listening is a conscious effort to really attend to what the other person is saying. And we'll come back to that. If you leave with only one thing you learned today, that is to go through this paradigm shift. Listening is not only the responsibility of the listener. That's too much of a responsibility for one person. I think if we look at the success of listening as contingent upon the success as the speaker, as well as the successful attention of the listener, then we're talking about where real listening and effective listening can come into play. The speaker must speak in ways that makes it easy for the audience to understand where they're going, what the organizational structure is, what's expected of them. If a question is asked, is it rhetorical, where I just think about it, or do they really want a response? Sometimes you go to a training and they ask a question and you're unsure, should I raise my hand? Should I say something? I don't know. And of course, I don't want to be the first one to do something silly that I'm not supposed to do. A good speaker makes it obvious what response he or she wants, right? And I always use the little trick that when people say, well, you're the listener, it's your responsibility. But when you point at someone else, you have three fingers here pointing right back at you. So it's our responsibility as the speakers also to speak in ways to help the listeners listen easier and as a result, more effectively. The objectives for today: to understand the importance of listening, what it means, exhibit appropriate listening behaviors, foster effective listening in others. Okay. And that will permeate what we do. Now, this comic strip that I'll show you, yeah. I know, I went too quickly. I know, because you were starting to read it already. And would she have been listening to me? No, so I remembered, right, three fingers back at me. I need to control what you see so that I determine what you see, when you see it, and that. So this is a group of reporters. And maybe some cocktails were involved, I don't know. But this is how things can kind of get a little crazy when you don't listen well. In the event those of you in the back of the audience cannot see this, I will also narrate it just because it's my favorite and I love it. Okay, you ready now?
I'm ready.
Okay, here it comes. The first reporter says, why hasn't my opponent taken as forceful a position on drugs? What may we infer from that? The other says that she isn't as against drugs as you are. The next person said, I just heard Mrs. Davenport isn't against drugs. Good Lord, she actually favors them? Down here, the word is that Davenport likes drugs. Well, I always suspected she used them. And then here we have someone who's in front of the camera with their microphone saying, and persistent rumors suggest Mrs. Davenport has a serious drug dependency. Yeah, Doonesbury is just wonderful. That's what I miss about newspapers.
Fake news.
Right. We didn't have it then. We had good comics.
Yeah. We have it now.
Yeah. But can we relate to this?
Oh, yeah.
Unfortunately, I think we can. In my household, we have one of my two sons living at home. He's 24. My husband and I, and then the furry kids. Well, the three of us who were eligible to vote voted for three different people in the recent elections. And there'd be times where one of us would want to have a discussion.
Oh boy is right.
And whenever one of them would make a point, I would be, where did you find it? It's out of context. It's just a sound bite. I want the historical context. I want to hear the whole speech. I don't like sound bites because you cannot have a true understanding of what the situation is. And it might be like that comic strip. You hear part, it's not complete, but you know what? We have this perceptual thing about us. We like things in good forms and we like things kind of tied up neatly. So we'll add our own details to bring completion to the story. And our own details may be farthest from the truth. Mm-hmm. Context is everything. Finding out the history is everything. Looking at your experience with Toastmasters, let me ask, how many of you have been Toastmasters less than a year? If you would raise your hand. That's more than half of you. Thank you. How many of you between 1 and 3 years? That's almost the other half. And the rest of you, are you more than?
10 years.
Mm-hmm. 10 years, same here. Okay, that's about a quarter. Okay, 5, 10, 15, 20, 5. I can't tell.
30.
crazy. So you've seen some changes. But what you're doing when you're new, and half of you are new, is you'll see through the training of what we should be doing, but sometimes you'll see that your club may do it a little differently. And you might think, why? Because I really thought this is the way we're supposed to do it. I want a historical context. Clubs can be unique as long as we adhere to the major policies. But sometimes we see a little uniqueness at each club. It is very helpful to understand why the club has evolved to do it that way. For example, sometimes the sergeant at arms is the one who starts, calls the meeting, bangs the gavel, but I know Jeremy doesn't want anyone banging the gavel except him or one of his girls, daughters. Yeah. Things happen differently at different clubs to greater or lesser degrees. Sometimes you come into a club and for some reason you're feeling, suspecting something's going on at a deeper level. I can't put my finger on it. I'm thinking those two people don't get along, or that there's probably a history, right? A historical context. And I think it's always nice to take things from a clean slate, interact. If it comes up, if it really influences the club, then obviously it might be something you need to deal with. But we'll come back to an example like that. Knowing what the objectives are and what we're focusing on here, what I'd like to do is look at what's called problem-solving responses, or problem-causing listening responses. Now, I think I slipped and said problem-solving because sometimes these responses are good, but more often than not, they're not so good in a situation, and actually may have some pretty serious effects by someone else. Just for a quick example, if you're not listening to someone who's brand new to the club, their knees are shaking, they're so nervous, their voice is cracking, and you have someone just sitting there texting or falling asleep, how do you think it feels to that new person, right? Half of you joined Toastmasters within 6 months. That would have been devastating. You might have thought, I'm not coming back. I'm just not feeling the support here. And that's just one example of how important listening is and how it's important to be aware of some listening responses that could be problematic, although there are opportunities where it can be beneficial, but for the most part, it's not. Let's look at them one at a time. And if you look on page 28 of the participant guide, it's all there for you so that you can listen, take additional notes, and see what you think about it. After I go through all of them, then we'll have you do something with that list. First one is a static listener. This person gives no overt signs of listening. If you went up to them and did this, they probably wouldn't blink. You did that well. You knew where I was going.
I did.
Right?
I've taken one of your courses before a couple of years ago.
Oh, wow. Well, welcome back.
So what's the page number?
28. It doesn't feel good to give a speech to someone who is just static. I don't know if they're getting it. It looks like they're not interested. I bet you they're planning their grocery list, right? You just don't know because you're getting no feedback. And remember, when you're giving a speech, it's not one-way communication. You're looking at your audience to get the feedback to decide, are they falling asleep? Are they disinterested? Do they get that faraway stare? And you know you might need to do something to bring them back and regain their attention. And that's valuable information that you should always be paying attention to so that you can do something about it. Remember, I'm also responsible for how well you listen, and I need to change my speaking in line with that. The monotonous feedback giver. And I worked for a person who did that. Drove me crazy. I wanted to say, shh, just don't, now and then. But it was every 2 or 3 seconds. And it was hard to get my thoughts together with him. And he would do it, bob his head. Yeah. That can be distracting. Am I the only one that's distracted by something like that?
No.
Yeah, I don't think so. Yes.
We have a manager at work that ends every question with, okay? Okay? Mm-hmm. Okay? Like, he needs our validation for
right.
him to be giving us orders.
Right.
It's like, you need Toastmasters.
You need to talk to the group separately and say, give him feedback when he speaks and say, yes, I get it. Wow, that makes sense. Because then he might be getting the validation and getting the feedback that he wants, and perhaps he'll stop saying okay. When I first started teaching, I would always end with, you know, and that was my way to elicit feedback. And the faculty who evaluated me brought it to my attention, and I thought, wow, this was valuable information. From that point on, I knew not to add a tag on like that. But if they need validation or affirmation that they're being heard, well, then as a listener, try to do that. Remember, we can juggle. We can listen. We can give feedback all at the same time. Thank you for sharing that example, Kelly. So when you are giving feedback, shake it up a little bit. Vary it. I like throwing in a paraphrase now and then. If I say, uh-huh, really? You really got mad at that? I would have gotten mad too. I mean, something that proves I'm really listening. But the there's no proof. They're still probably planning their grocery list or what to do tonight when they get home. All right? You don't know. Overly expressive listener. What are you doing when you get home, April?
Throw my stuff down and fall on the bed because I'm tired.
You are throwing your stuff down and you're going to fall on the bed? Oh my gosh! Is that crazy? Got a little head rush there. Overly expressive. Was it that exciting what she was going to do? No. But when people are overly expressive and they're just over the top, I mean, yes, it kind of wakes you up. Did I wake up anyone? But it's not always conducive to good interactions because you're just so over the top and you're afraid to say anything else for fear that they're going to have another overly expressive utterance of something that's kind of shocking. You want to keep it appropriate to the topic. I mean, if someone says they just won the Powerball jackpot and because I'm such a good friend, they're going to share it with me, do you think I'm going to say, oh, that's great? Right? Especially if I trusted them, right? I don't care. Anything's better. Right? So save it for when it's true and when it's truly felt. Otherwise, people will not understand how important your reaction is and the strength of your reaction if you're overly expressive to everything. Reader-writer. Now, this is something that can be bad, but I'll be the first to say sometimes it's good because some of you, stop that writing, Mary. No, she's taking notes, right? Some people say, just sit there and listen. But this is how I listen, right? Mm-hmm. It reinforces it. And as I'm writing down keywords, I'm saying it, I'm thinking it, I'm listening. The time it's not good is when it's disruptive. It's where you're writing something and it's that grocery list. It's your dream vacation destinations. Something that keeps you from what's going on in here that you don't want to do. Are there any doodlers out there who like to doodle as they listen? That's about a fifth of you, okay? Can you still listen and doodle?
Yep. Sure.
Usually yes. And if that helps you focus, then doodle away. But then there's people who do this. Remember, I teach college.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. You know, like, stop texting. I'm not texting. I wasn't born yesterday, right? If you're taking notes, and I have notes on my phone, an app, where when I go to a doctor's office, I just let them know I'm taking notes. This way they know I'm not answering email and texting while they're talking to me, just so that they understand. It helps me be a better listener when I can take some notes. But if it's unrelated, or you're reading something else, and then you come back and you're like, whoa, I just missed that whole 10 minutes, then that's not conducive to listening and being an effective listener. Couple more, eye avoider. Now, this is where someone's looking elsewhere, and sometimes we just need a mental break. And sometimes it helps just to look somewhere, relax your eyes, and then you come back and you're a little refreshed. We just need to make sure we just make them short. Right? Some people go away mentally and relax their eyes for too long, and then sometimes when they're relaxing their eyes, the eyelids kind of close. Yeah. And they say, I'm still listening. It's like, yeah, no, I don't think so. Right?
It's when they start snoring that you know that it's not.
That's right. Yeah. I've had them put their heads down, and some people say, why don't you go up and just slam the desk? I can't do that. I mean, that's mean. Sometimes I'm super tired, too, and I get it. But after reminding them twice, then I make them say everybody's name or something like that. And they hate it, and I like it because it wakes them up. All right. So it's helpful to listen to someone, and it's helpful to keep the eye contact so you stay focused on the prize. Preoccupied listener. Again. Thinking about going home, jumping into bed, kicking back, maybe turning the TV on, all right? And that's okay. And sometimes when the gas tank gets low, I might be in a session and think, oh my gosh, I won't make it home. I'm running on fumes. I need to get gas. And you keep thinking, okay, get gas, get gas, get gas. And I'm not listening. So I put on my Palm Pilot. Who's old enough to remember Palm Pilots in here? Well, I don't like things that you have to recharge. I mean, yes, I have my phone and the computer. So I write it on this Palm Pilot. I have a leftover note from earlier. It was when I had to run to another session and steal the computer because we're sharing it to use it in my session. I may wash it off, but it's there and I can tell. And once I write it down, then it's like, okay, I'm able to focus. Because I wrote it down somewhere. Or I'll go on my phone and I'll set an alarm that when I know I'm done here, the alarm goes off, I look at it, it says, get gas. All right, whatever way you can do to manage your ability to handle when you're preoccupied by something and then do something about it. One more is the waiting listener. Now this a lot can do with politics. All right. Let's say you are having a political debate with someone and you're listening to their point, but you're also collecting ammunition to tuck away, right? Because when they're done speaking, I've collected so much ammunition, I'm just going to pounce on them with all this ammunition. But you know what? As I'm trying to prepare what I'm saying next, they may say something that I miss. Taking a step back. A good rhetorical device when you're trying to persuade someone on something is to agree with them in part, to get them showing that, yes, I understand, I agree on this, I agree on that, and I agree on that. But then take this part where you turn it around and say, but that's why I don't agree with that, and instead I go with this, and here's why. Well, what if you were so preoccupied with how you're going to use that ammunition and pounce on your audience or the person you're having a discussion with that you didn't hear that twisted part and you open your mouth, all kinds of stuff comes out and they say, you didn't hear me. You weren't listening. And that's when you insert the foot in the mouth and it's obvious that you were being a waiting listener. Now, is it safe to say that we all do these from time to time? I think it's also safe to say we all have very busy lives. And here you are at Toastmasters Leadership Institute. You're learning all these things about what you need to do. And I bet you the thought has crossed your mind where, I didn't realize I'd have to do all this stuff, right? But hopefully you've connected with other people so that you can rely on them for support. And there should be people in your club who have done this before, so you can use them as a mentor. What I'd like you to do is just think right now for a moment. Which one of these, one, do you think is the one you do most often? Again, true confessions, there's no guilt here. We all do it. And tell one or two other people. Which one of these do you really need to work on? All right, take a minute, think which one, and then when you have one, please turn to one or two people and share with them. And you can make a minute. Okay, everyone, come on back.
Write down that one.
Thank you so much. I know some of you brings up other issues, and I heard the husband word, and Isn't that amazing how perhaps when I was going through this list, you thought of certain people who might behave like that, right? And you might take an opportunity to have a meta conversation with them where you're talking about communication itself, of course, using communication. But be brave, and there's no liability. Don't come back and say, well, Diane, you said I should. I'm not saying you should. I'm saying it's a possibility of something that you can do. So let's take just a minute for someone to throw out which one you use. Yes?
I'm a preoccupied listener.
Okay, who else said preoccupied listener? Oh, wow. That's more than half of you. Could it be that we have so much going on in our heads that are pulling at our attention? Why do you think it happens?
I like people, I've lived most of my life on the East Coast, so I like people to be very direct and to the point.
Yep.
And it's been difficult for me living on the West Coast because there's more formality and building in a relationship and language.
Yep.
And it's just been a difficult, so
Yep.
I'm done.
Yeah. I'm from Brooklyn. Was there till I was 19. Everything's on a New York minute. I get it. And then Arizona is even more. We'll get to it. Right?
Yes.
But your mind. And another reason is we can listen to about 400 words per minute, but most people only speak maybe 120 words per minute. So we got a lot of extra space in our mind to do other things. You know, like I'm listening as they're texting, as they're playing a game on their phones. I'm listening. I can repeat every word you said, but did you really get it? It's one thing to repeat every word, but did you really get it? Wow, that was a lot of you. Somebody else give me a different one that you thought. Yeah.
Reader-writer.
Is it related to what's going on, or is it?
It depends on the situation.
Okay.
Because, as I said earlier, I use telephones in my work once I've got their name and address and where I'm sending information to, and then they want to tell me the story of their life.
Oh. That's when you pull up the game on the computer or the news.
20-minute phone call, I've gotten all their information, and how their husband died and left them alone.
Oh. I have a solution for that.
Oh, all right, we have a solution.
Yeah,
let's hear it.
If I'm on my office phone and I have somebody like that, I call myself on my cell phone. But excuse me, I've got to take this call.
Okay. I draw lizards and flowers.
Oh.
Lizards.
Well, that might sound more like a coping mechanism. I don't know.
Yeah. Part of my job is dealing with widows, widowers, and disabled people.
Oh, sure.
I work with exemptions for the county, but...
And they all have a story.
They all have their story.
That's right.
And they're all over 70, and nobody wants to listen to them.
Yeah, and maybe they don't have many people to talk to. Did you have your hand up, Christy?
The waiting listener.
Who's a waiting listener? You're waiting to ambush.
I call it both the occupied waiting listener.
Oh, so I asked you to pick one. How many of you said, yeah, anyone? Yeah.
My struggle is my pacing style is a lot faster than my husband's.
Okay.
My husband's a very slow, deliberate speaker, and I'm like, get to the point, or he'll get halfway through a sentence, and it sounds like he's stopped.
No, oh, yeah.
And I'm like, I just go, and he's right. Like, seriously, you're not listening to
oh,
me.
And you know what I didn't show? The thought completing lesson.
Yes.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. Yeah, and you may not. That's the thing. You may not know.
Well,
yes.
One of the things, coming back to your point, is when I read a study about the pace at which people talk.
Mm-hmm.
The ones that speak most rapid, New Yorkers, and one people from Minnesota. As you go further south,
mm-hmm.
it slows down dramatically.
Mm-hmm. Big time.
Is it a lifestyle?
What's that?
Is it about the lifestyle?
I don't know if it's just the regional culture. Of how things are slower in some places. I mean, big cities, New York, Chicago, and whatnot. You got to dog-eat-dog. You got to really get in there and speak fast because it's that New York minute mentality. Here, the traffic is so much different, and you can look across and see the horizon and see the sunrise, sunset. That makes me slow down, which is one of the main reasons why I said, enough of Brooklyn, I'm coming out here. Yeah. So, yeah, it could be a lot of reasons. It could be how you were raised. It could just be how quickly your mind works.
Yeah.
Could mean impatience. It could just mean you've got a whole lot of things to do, and you need to get to them. And so stop taking the scenic route and just cut to the chase.
Yeah.
Right? Okay, we need to move on to a TED Talk. And even though we can identify with a lot of those, think about the effect it will have on your on the listeners, on your families. Because if Christy is hurrying her husband up, but he feels that he's growing in intimacy in the relationship by telling her how he felt and what happened and the result and whatnot, then that could be problematic in the relationship, all right? You have to watch. If it's a new Toastmaster, and you're writing and reading and doing something else, they say, oh my gosh, I thought Kelly liked me and she's being so rude. I must be saying really stupid things, right? And I know you don't mean to have anything negative come out, but there can be a response to that. And Christy, I'm not saying that
we've had hiccups because of that. Mm-hmm. I had to learn how
I knew
to
it.
Slow down and pace more slowly.
Yes.
And wait sometimes 5 to 7 minutes for him to complete a thought.
Yeah. And it's about finding a balance between the sender or the speaker and the listener.
Mm-hmm.
And it's negotiated. It really is. All right. Something I always like to do in here is share my love for a guy named Ted. And you know what? My husband is totally cool with my infatuation with Ted, and the Ted I'm talking about is TED Talks. So TED Talks are great. It's a 7 minutes of a jewel because Julian Treasure is one of my current favorite TED Talk speakers. I did a session on Swing Your Pendulum on at the last district conference, and it was something I'd been wanting to do for years, these ideas I had for years. And showed a different one with Ann Cuddy. If you've seen her in the power positions and whatnot, that's classic, really good things. But this one is about language, and it's so well produced, and it really challenges us as listeners to have these exercises just with the sounds that we hear. His main points are on page 29 of your handout. If you want to write additional ones, of course you can, but these are it's the gist of what Julian Treasure talks about. So please enjoy this. We'll have a few minutes to talk about it.
We are losing our listening. We spend roughly 60% of our communication time listening, but we're not very good at it. We retain just 25% of what we hear. Now, not you, not this talk, but that is generally true. Let's define listening as making meaning from sound. It's a mental process, and it's a process of extraction. We use some pretty cool techniques to do this. One of them is pattern recognition. So in a cocktail party like this, if I say, David, Sarah, pay attention, some of you just sat up. We recognize patterns to distinguish noise from signal, and especially our name. Differencing is another technique we use. If I left this pink noise on for more than a couple of minutes, you would literally cease to hear it. We listen to differences, we discount sounds that remain the same. And then there is a whole range of filters. These filters take us from all sound down to what we pay attention to. Most people are entirely unconscious of these filters, but they actually create our reality in a way because they tell us what we're paying attention to right now. I'll give you one example of that. Intention is very important in sound, in listening. When I married my wife, I promised her that I would listen to her every day as if for the first time. Now that's something I fall short of on a daily basis. But it's a great intention to have in a relationship. But that's not all. Sound places us in space and in time. If you close your eyes right now in this room, you're aware of the size of the room from the reverberation and the bouncing of the sound off the surfaces. And you're aware of how many people are around you because of the micro noises you're receiving. And sound places us in time as well, because sound always has time embedded in it. In fact, I would suggest that our listening is the main way that we experience the flow of time from past to future. So, sonority is time and meaning, a great quote. I said at the beginning, we're losing our listening. Why did I say that? Well, there are a lot of reasons for this. First of all, we invented ways of recording. First, writing, then audio recording, and now video recording as well. The premium on accurate and careful listening has simply disappeared. Secondly, the world is now so noisy, with this cacophony going on visually and auditorily, it's just hard to listen. It's tiring to listen. Many people take refuge in headphones, but they turn big public spaces like this, shared soundscapes, into millions of tiny little personal sound bubbles. In this scenario, nobody's listening to anybody. We're becoming impatient. We don't want oratory anymore, we want sound bites. And the art of conversation is being replaced, dangerously, I think, by personal broadcasting. I don't know how much listening there is in this conversation, which is sadly very common, especially in the UK. We're becoming desensitized. Our media have to scream at us with these kind of headlines in order to get our attention. And that means it's harder for us to pay attention to the quiet, the subtle, the understated. This is a serious problem that we're losing our listening. This is not trivial. Because listening is our access to understanding. Conscious listening always creates understanding. And only without conscious listening can these things happen. A world where we don't listen to each other at all is a very scary place indeed. So I'd like to share with you five simple exercises, tools you can take away with you to improve your own conscious listening. Would you like that? Good. The first one is silence. Just 3 minutes a day of silence is a wonderful exercise to reset your ears and to recalibrate so that you can hear the quiet again. If you can't get absolute silence, go for quiet. That's absolutely fine. Second, I call this the mixer. So even if you're in a noisy environment like this, and we all spend a lot of time in places like this, listen in the coffee bar to how many channels of sound can I hear? How many individual channels in that mix am I listening to? You can do it in a beautiful place as well, like a lake. How many birds am I hearing? Where are they? Where are those ripples? It's a great exercise for improving the quality of your listening. Third, this exercise I call savoring, and this is a beautiful exercise. It's about enjoying mundane sounds. This, for example, is my tumble dryer. It's a waltz. One, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three. I love it. Or just try this one on for size. So mundane sounds can be really interesting if you pay attention. I call that the hidden choir. It's around us all the time. The next exercise is probably the most important of all of these. If you just take one thing away, this is listening positions. The idea that you can move your listening position to what's appropriate to what you're listening to. This is playing with those filters. Remember I gave you those filters at the beginning? It's starting to play with them as levers to get conscious about them and to move to different places. These are just some of the listening positions or scales of listening positions that you can use. There are many. Have fun with that. It's very exciting. And finally, an acronym. You can use this in listening in communication. If you're in any one of those roles, and I think that probably is everybody who's listening to this talk. The acronym is RASA, which is the Sanskrit word for juice or essence. And RASA stands for receive, which means pay attention to the person, appreciate, making little noises like, oh, okay. Summarize, the word so is very important in communication, and ask questions afterwards. Now, sound is my passion, it's my life. I wrote a whole book about it, so I live to listen. That's too much to ask for most people. But I believe that every human being needs to listen consciously in order to live fully, connected in space and in time to the physical world around us, connected in understanding to each other, not to mention spiritually connected, because every spiritual path I know of has listening and contemplation at its heart. That's why we need to teach listening in our schools as a skill. Why is it not taught? It's crazy. And if we can teach listening in our schools, we can take our listening off that slippery slope to that dangerous, scary world that I talked about and move it to a place where everybody is consciously listening all the time, or at least capable of doing it. Now, I don't know how to do that, but this is TED. And I think the TED community is capable of anything. So I invite you to connect with me, connect with each other, take this mission out, and let's get listening taught in schools and transform the world in one generation to a conscious listening world, a world of connection, a world of understanding, and a world of peace. Thank you for listening to me today.
Wasn't that good? I really like it. Anything that Julian Treasure does, either in a book or a TED Talk, is excellent. It would be something that I would recommend. I've watched several different ones from him.
These are available on TED.com.
Yeah.
Very
yeah. And awesome. The beauty of it here is we don't have access to the internet. It's downloadable. You can put it on a jump drive and they give you permission to use it at will, just to share that insight with the community, which is great that they're not this money making thing.
I think you just described Toastmasters in a nutshell.
Yes. And isn't it great that we can share all these things? And that's why when I first pitched the idea to have a listening session, they said, listening, do you think anyone will be interested? The morning session, we had over 70 people, almost 80 people in here, and they were around the edges. It was pretty crazy. But when you think about it, remember when you make that paradigm shift that listening is for the audience as well as the speaker needs to speak in a way that's conducive and makes it easier for my audience to listen. But yeah, that's what Toastmasters is and what we should be doing at our meetings is watching that any of the responses that we give may be problematic. Even though the intention might not be to be disrespectful or to make the speaker feel uncomfortable, we need to humble ourselves to the fact that it may very well leave an impression that I'm not meaning to leave. That's why those problem responses are good to look at. And then the TED Talk, I think the main thing I get from that is to really train my listening and stop being such a lackadaisical listener and really be more critical in paying attention to the subtleties. If I ask someone, how's your day going? They say, oh, fine. I might say, good, great. When in reality, how they said it meant they're not having such a good day. And I should stop and say, well, tell me about your day. What's going on? Then you know to delve. But if you're truly not listening with your heart, then you won't know to delve. And if we're still operating on that New York minute, we may not stop to see that this person really needs to talk. And that's what we're there at Toastmasters, is really to be supportive of each other. And half of you might think, well, I'm so new, I don't even know what I'm doing. It's okay, it's a path, it's a journey. You never get to a destination because there are so many different layers, and with pathways changing things up, It's going to be really exciting. And you'll have some people not getting it and saying, oh, I'm used to this. But what you'll say is, let's discover it together. And we'll find out together in our group. Yes?
What you just said about new members not knowing what to do. Mm-hmm. One of the reasons that we love new members in Toastmasters is because they bring a fresh perspective.
Yep.
And those of us who have been members for 10 years,
for 30 years, mm-hmm.
you learn from new members, don't you?
Yeah.
Every single time.
Right.
They bring such a fresh perspective. Don't think right. you don't have something to offer.
They ever. Bring a fresh perspective only if we're listening for it.
Yes.
Right? If you're not hearing it, then the message is incomplete, and you don't want to do that. I want to thank you for being here this afternoon, for staying here. I have one more thing to ask of you, and that is, would you please fill out the evaluation form? Several of us read all the evaluations. It's how I try to make my facilitation better. But I thank you. I wish you well. And this lovely lady will be at the door to take it from you. There's also a whole TLI evaluation, if I'm not mistaken. It's blue. I see some blue sheets out there. If you could fill that out. If there's another type of session you would like to see, jot it down. We definitely look at that on the curriculum committee. But have a wonderful time. If you ever have questions about anything Toastmaster related, reach out. We will be there for you. Yeah, it's a great ride. Thank you so much.